or bite, also known as bite ball. It's been a very long time. I made a video about it, and I remember making videos about Obite, and also at the beach in Mombasa. It was in Zanzibar, very close by to here, and how user-friendly it is and how genius I think the system works. We are now 2 years further. The mistakes I've made is just underestimating. Actually, Biteball didn't perform very well during the bull market in price. Now it has rebranded in Obite. If you compare to other projects, it continued to lose ranking in the hierarchy, and due to that, it didn't go up so much as I expected, and due to that, I didn't sell at a high price. But of course, also was infected with the hodl strategy or mentality that I've come back to today. But that's a pity that Obite didn't succeed in really at least gaining its market share. It didn't succeed in that during the bull run, and basically I was still promoting it in the middle of 2017. I started promoting it before it launched, and it was a very good advice, of course, because it launched at a zero value. You could get them for free in exchange for Bitcoin. Registering Bitcoin and not giving or paying Bitcoin, just registering them, and you get them for free. And then the value went up to $10 when it started trading in January or December of 2016, January 2017. And then it went up from $10 to $200 in the middle of the year, of middle of 2017, and then it went up at the end of the year to $1,000. But from 200 to 1,000 is only 5x. Many coins did a lot more in that last phase of the bubble. And after that, it collapsed during the bear market of 2018 from about $1,000 to $30 was the low. We're now at $40 or $50. But what's often forgotten, even by the owners, is that actually you should also look at the amount of G-bytes or bytes that you got for free by holding bytes. So if you had bought $10 of bytes or 1 gigabyte for $10 in January 2017, you would have gotten about three more. And so one would turn into four. And so basically, your $10 went to not $200 in the middle of the year, but $1,000. And by the end of the year, it not went to $1,000, but to $4,000. So it was a tremendous, actually, return, but you can't see it in the chart because of the way it was issued. After that, it also went down a lot, not to the current $50, because you got four of them, so it's $200, but it's still a drop from $4,000 to $200. It's still 95% off or 97% off. But as you can see, actually, looking at these valuations, actually it's not that bad. But that's only valid for those that entered at the start of the project and held, and got those extra G-bytes as a reward for holding G-bytes. So that's not the case for many people that bought at tops. And if you bought in the middle of the year in 2017, then you did pay $200 for one, and today it's worth $50. So, and you didn't get any more G-bytes in the meantime, because the distribution stopped in the second part of 2017. So, as usual, it was interesting for the early adopters, but not for the late adopters. But which project is not, huh? I think that's a normal. But now we have a bear market that will soon finish with a bang. But what after? I haven't talked about Obyte for the last year because I don't believe in the strategy to invest in smaller coins during the bear market. I don't think that's wise. I think you should invest in only the big coins during the bear market. And then the first year and probably 2 years, just hold on to the big coins, and only after 2 years diversify into smaller coins. So that's why I didn't talk about it. I think the timing is off. But in the case of Obyte, since I only invest in two projects, I do want to talk about it. And also, there's this coin. Obyte has two coins. It has Bytes and Black Bytes. And actually, the Black Bytes are so small in market cap, only 1 to 2 million worth. And it's so illiquid that if you want to build a stash, it's going to take you many, many months. Unless you pump the price times 2x, but who wants to do that? So it takes you many, many months, possibly years, depending on how much you want to invest. Let's say the market is only 2 million, so you want to invest 100k in Black Bytes. Well, it's going to take years. If you want to just wait for your orders to get filled, maybe so, maybe no. But that means that you do have to actually start buying much sooner than when you expect prices to finally go up. So, and I think that's still worth it. So how has Obyte been evolving? And what is Obyte? I will make a new video here about it, and I hope it's of interest to you. So I think Obyte has been evolving okay. Tony is still the founder and lead developer, and still has a very big impact on the project, which I think is very positive. Founders that stick with the project are a plus, and every project is led by a strong lead. There is no escaping that. But it still makes the project very vulnerable. Normally, as projects become bigger, you get more talented people that can also drive the project in case something goes wrong with the founder. But even that is a little bit an illusion, because of the biggest companies in the world, Microsoft, the moment Bill Gates left, well, went down the drain. Even the biggest companies in the world can't really replace a founder. Sometimes it's rare that you see decent follow-up. Apple, the same, Steve Jobs is gone, and yes, it continues to go up and peak out, but the foundations are not built anymore in such a way that it can do that same performance as in the past. So let's keep it real. Yes, it depends a lot on Tony, but I do think he's still doing a good job. I've not been tracing down the exact activities over the past year, but it seems to be chugging along. Things are being built. The rebranding has just been done. The wallet keeps being updated. The project works well. I enjoy using the wallet. Of course, there's a big difference between using Bytes and Black Bytes. If you only use Bytes, it's very simple to use, and to back up, you just only need one paper backup, and the job is done. You can just use the wallet without concerns for losing it. With Black Bytes, it's a different story. Since it's built so differently, it's basically data packages that you send to each other. So you really have to back it up every time you receive them. And that's very cumbersome. But you can easily replace that by just setting up a multi-device wallet. And from time to time, syncing your other wallets. You can have one not on your phone, because for Black Bytes you do need hard disks, SSD, and so you want to have that on a laptop or a desktop. But you take two, or you do it with a friend or family member, that you set up a multi-device wallet, and then every time you receive Black Bytes, or every month, or you ask your friend, or you use your other device to sync it, and then you have two copies, and so then you're good. Because you lose one, and of course you keep them in separate locations, you lose one, you still have the other one. So you can quite solve that, but it requires more work. Privacy is not an easy thing to solve in cryptocurrency, because it needs to be public per definition to basically verify if there's no fraud, there are no coins being issued out of thin air. So So it's very difficult to create a privacy coin. And the leader Monero solves it by mixing on-chain the coins, but that can later prove to be reverse engineered. They claim it's not possible, but even with them, the first few years, even though they were saying it was private, it turned out to be not private, and I don't know how much percent, 95% or 98% of payments were reverse, were traceable. So this can happen again in the future, because all information is available on the blockchain. It's mixed, but it's available. So you can, if you have enough intelligence or computer power, possibly reveal the privacy in the future. That's a weakness of Monero. Another weakness of Monero is that it's very unuser friendly. That's the Bitcoin BTC philosophy, users be damned, Linux philosophy, like user friendliness is a problem to be solved for the user, not for the developer, and that's not working. That's never gonna get widespread adoption. And you see the same philosophy going on with Monero. Try to install a wallet, a mobile wallet, so that's easy to use. Good luck. Still, after so many years of development. Then you have the other competitor, Zcash, and the problem there is that yes, they do use encryption to create privacy. But of course, encryption can also be cracked. But I have to say, probably it's pretty solid. It's another alternative. The problem with Zcash is that the philosophy of the founder is it doesn't add up. He doesn't want Zcash to be used in dark markets and. He seems to be a bit naive in how you can get adoption with a privacy coin. Of course, the definition of a privacy coin is it's private. You can't steer who's gonna use it. And if it's truly private, yes, of course it's gonna be used in dark markets first. These are the most fragile markets. They get hunted down by government agencies the most. They value privacy the highest. So of course they're gonna be the first user gonna use it. So, I mean, if you're gonna work against that, how are you gonna achieve adoption? Also, the value of these coins is much higher. It's almost a billion, and we're still in a bear market. It's still a billion, or it's 800 million. These are tremendous valuations. So, I think with Black Bytes that's not the case. The privacy is created in a very different way. So instead of having a public blockchain, it doesn't have it. It's basically it is using the public blockchain of Bytes. So every time you do a Black Byte transaction, you have to pay in Bytes for the transaction to the public blockchain. But the Black Bytes themselves are sent directly to the other user. And it's in the Black Bytes themselves or data packages that contain the transaction history. So there is no public blockchain for Black Bytes. It's private information sent from one party to the other. But the other party can verify the whole transaction history in the coins themselves. So it's a different way to create privacy that, I think, makes a chance to find a use case, which it hasn't yet, but it may in the future, and then the value will go up a lot. This is a project where you start from a technological approach, where Tony invented a great way to create a privacy coin, a very different than other people did, and he created it, and it's there now. You can see it works, but the next step is to see it being marketed. Still has to happen. Because the OBI team is not marketing Black Bytes. It's just there. This is a peer-to-peer project. It's, I think, the job of the users here, the investors, the people that invest in the coin, to see it being adopted and to promote it to other people. This is also how Monero has done an amazing job in promoting their currency. It's by the users, done by the users, to other people, done by the investors for the most part, who then evangelize the coin to other people. The same needs to happen with BlackBytes. But it hasn't happened yet. So for investors, it's a good way to get started. You don't want to do that after it's been evangelized. You want to invest before it's being evangelized and then do the evangelizing yourself if you believe it's a valuable project. So that's still waiting to be done, but it's still also an opportunity to do. Also, with BlackBytes has the same advantage of Bytes, is that there's a business model. So the way the coins are issued is that there's still a big stash being owned by the Obyte Foundation now, that's being has been set up or is in the process of. And so this stash is still 30% or so that's left from all coins that will be issued. Is still owned by the foundation and is used to finance projects that push forward the project. And the same is being done with the Bytes. So I think that's great, because that also leaves like the opportunity for people to get paid to do valuable work. That's often missing in the projects that don't have a stash, where the stash is only issued inflation via miners like Bitcoin BTC. Or Monero, where it has to come all from volunteers and we'll have to see. The same with Bitcoin Cash, a project I believe strongly in. I think the business model of voluntarism or volunteering, in this case not voluntarism, volunteering can work and has shown to be working with Bitcoin BTC, as it was founded that way, Bitcoin, and it did conquer the world. So the business model has proven to work in the past, but well, other business models have also proven to work, such as having a piece of the inflation go to marketing and development team, as Dash has first done and proved to work well for them. Makes sense to me. Zcash also has done that. Piece of the inflation goes to development team and they are doing okay. So it's a different business model, and I believe it can work. So yeah, that was it about Obyte. I think yeah, you have to buy Bytes in order to buy BlackBytes. I bought the exchange. There's only one exchange. It's called Freebe. I will post the link below. You can click on that and that's the website, but actually to access the exchange is via the Obyte wallet. So you just download the wallet and then you go to the chat and you add different kind of bots. These are different kind of apps you can add within the wallet. And one app or one bot is the Freebe, BlackBytes exchange. And then you can via the chat see the open orders, open buy and open sell orders, but you can also see on the website the order book graphically, and that way you can place your orders via the Obyte wallet. But you do need to buy Bytes in order to buy BlackBytes. I hope some of you are interested to do so. Thanks so much for watching.